And now it's my extreme pleasure to introduce Ashanti Branch, who was raised by a single mother on welfare in Oakland and went on to study engineering at Caltech, San Luis Obispo. A civil engineer in his first career, Ashanti found his passion for teaching while tutoring struggling students. In 2004, as a first-year teacher, Ashanti started the Ever Forward Club to provide a support group for African American and Latino males who were not achieving to the level of their potential. The Ever Forward Club has helped 100% of its members graduate high school. Ashanti Branch is on a mission to change the way that students interact with their education and the way schools interact with students, which is so important. After being featured in the Mask You Live In documentary and fellowships at Stanford's D School Campaign for Black Male Achievement and the Gratitude Network, Ashanti has launched the hashtag Million Mask Movement to connect people all over the world in a self-reflective experience that helps people visualize and realize I am not alone. A warm welcome to you, Ashanti. Appreciate you being here, sharing your great work and this wonderful experience for providers here in Alameda County, and I'll let you take it away. Thanks.
Thank you, Beth. Thank you. I am really excited to be here with you today. Thank you for making time to be here. And what I'm hoping during this time together is that not only will this be something that will nourish and uplift you, it may not feel all the points uplifting. It may feel they have to get a little rough before it gets to the uplifting part. But what I hope is that when you leave here, it will add value to how you connect to the folks who you work with, the people you serve, the people you love, people who love you, and the community around us. Today is not for me. You're probably going to see very little statistics today. You're probably going to see very little data. I'm probably going to show very little charts, if any. Today is going to be some heart work. Like, I'm not here to tell you how to do your job. I am not here to give you a list of how to fix anything. I'm here to help us take a journey from the head to the heart. And here's what I believe around that work. I believe that heart work is hard work. I learned growing up that, Ashanti, your needs, your whatever you need, what's important to you doesn't matter. Your job is to take care of others. That's how I was raised to believe that type of belief. And what I learned and what I'm still learning today is that I matter too. And you imagine that sounds so simple, right? Like, of course you matter, right? But if you grew up believing that your job was to take care of everyone else, when did you become important? When did you become the one who gets to focus on you and not feel selfish? And I feel like, oh, because I'm giving myself some care, then that means I'm leaving other people behind. I don't know where that comes from, but I'm telling you how my life has, the journey has brought us to today. And so I want you to just give your best. And so maybe in order for us to get ready for how we're going to give our best, I just want to make sure I understand how you are right now, how you're doing. So I'll do it in two ways. Let's first start with, if you in the chat can write a number on a scale from 1 to 10, let's say 1 is the worst and 10 is the best. Just how are you feeling right now? Just take a quick deep breath, an inventory, you know, just make it a sum average mean of how you're feeling right now. And just, okay, how am I feeling right now? And just put that number in the chat. And what I have often tried to do, and thank you for those who are putting numbers in the chat. And the reason that this is important is because I come here, you know, even before I drank an energy drink, like, I got myself into this optimum level. I'm like, okay, let's go. We're gonna do this. I was in here early, making sure my sound was working. I tried to do all the things to prepare because I try and put myself there. But sometimes, truth be told, if I was going to be really honest, sometimes when I hear the bio, I'm a little concerned, because the bio is this beautiful story of highlights. And if I'm going to be a little more honest with you today, like, you know, I yelled at somebody on the freeway today. Just let me be honest. I yelled at somebody on the freeway today. So I'm in the fast lane and the person is like not moving fast. And I can't get around them because there's blockages over here and there's a carpool lane over here. So I'm like, come on, person, let's move. Now there's a mile in front of this person. So I just need to get around you and I can keep moving. I don't need to bother you, you know? And so finally I get some room on the side. So I go around. And as I get on the side of this person, I just have to look like, what are you doing? Like, you're in a fast lane. You're not going fast. What's the problem? And as I get to that point where I'm past the person is literally like this. They're driving with their knee and they're So I honk my horn. I've had a horn right here. I'll show you what it sounded like. I honk my horn. And I'm like, now they couldn't hear me because my window was up. I don't do that. I live in the Bay Area, so we don't play around with it. I just said, what's wrong with you? Now they knew what I meant by my body language. If you have any kind of perception of body language, like they knew what I meant. You're going to kill somebody. You're going to kill yourself. You're going to kill others because you here doing whatever you're doing on your phone, like, and you're going slow. How about that? Let's say if you want to be on your phone, do it over there, out of my way. Let me just get to work. So I yelled at somebody on the freeway today. And that's not in the bio, right? It's not in the bio. So sometimes I feel the bio is like, it's only part of me. And maybe if you have ever got sucked into one of these devices, maybe you got sucked into the highlight reels. You watching everybody else's highlight reel, right? And you can only know that you're behind the scenes story. So you're like comparing your life, the whole life, to everyone else's highlight reel sometimes. And maybe you don't. Maybe you just think about the teenagers in your life who get sucked into these billion-dollar devices that are causing us to believe that we're not enough, that we're not worthy if someone doesn't click or like our stuff, that if somebody doesn't take our video and make it go viral, that we don't feel validated. Now, maybe as adults, we've already passed that, but let me just be really honest. Like, I'm gonna be as honest as I can today, as much as I can. And just so you get clear, like, I at some point never even knew there was a heart button on Instagram. A teenager told me, it's like, dude, Branch, you got a bunch of likes on that thing. I'm like, what do you mean? They're like, that little heart right there at the bottom, see the red dot? That means that somebody was liking your stuff. I'm like, what? How did you know that? That's what it is. I'm like, oh, so I clicked the little heart. And then I see this list of things that people had liked my stuff. I was like, what? Dopamine kicked in. Now, I don't know how many of you are addicted to dopamine. Hopefully not, but it's a powerful thing. So, and it's free. It's kind of free. It's financially free, but it's emotionally costing. But I'm like, wait a minute, you mean that's what that means? So now, every time I open my phone, I'm looking for the red dot by the heart. Now, I remember one time I was on BART heading to a meeting in San Francisco, and I remember it like it was yesterday. BART doors closed. I get in, and pre-COVID, I pull out my phone. I'm just like, boom, checking anything. And I look at the heart, and there's no red dot. And I felt a wave of unhealthy emotions cross over my body. Like, what the heck? I know I posted something amazing this morning. And in about the split 20 seconds while I was getting irritated that no one had liked my thing since the last time I opened the app, I was like, they got me. Like, the people who make these, they make money because they get attention. And if they get you looking back in here over and over and over again, picking it up, checking it, that's how they get richer. Now, I'm not here to talk bad about rich people or about telephones. I love my phone, but I'm talking about the dopamine hit that got me as an adult who teaches people about emotions, who I got sucked in looking for a little red dot on a heart. How powerful that is. And how powerful it is for kids that we work with who may not have the emotional intelligence that we should have. And as much as I should have it, I know how often I get sucked into every time I feel this phone vibrate, I want to pick it up. Sometimes the phone's not even in my pocket and I swear my pocket is vibrating. I feel like, wait, did my phone just ring? And it's not even in my pocket. I'm like, what's going on with you, Ashanti? You have this image that's connected to this device that sometimes is not doing you any service, any good service. You're like, what is this? Talk about cell phones? No, I'm just getting this ready. I'm just getting real with you right now because we're about to jump in a little deeper. But I just wanted you to know that I'm asking you, wherever you are right now, wherever you checked in, to just give your best. Now, let me ask you this. If you answered that question the most truthfully you could, awesome. But if you answered it based on the first number you saw that popped in there, because the first number that popped in was a 10, right? And maybe you felt, well, I don't want to mess up the energy in the room. So maybe you had a little standard deviation. I'll go two less than the high. I don't want to go too far low. Like maybe you had a number that you wanted to put, but you're like, ah, no, no one's putting other numbers. But there are some numbers that are not at a 10, that are not a 9 or 8. And so what we're going to do is we're going to do a poll right now. And I'm going to have you to put a number on a scale from 1 to 10 based on how you're feeling right now. If you can do that, I just want you to, and this is anonymous, right? So it's not going to be connected to you, but if you can just put a number on how you're feeling right now on a scale from 1 to 10, and maybe the same number. There's no judgment here. I just want us to become aware of where do we get to be our full authentic selves? Where are the places in our life that let us be all that we need to be? And maybe if somebody were to do some math, if there's any mathematicians in the room, you could look at the numbers in the chat and look at the numbers on the, I'm in the poll right now, or let's give about 10 more seconds, right? If anybody else wants to put it in, and I'm gonna just close it so you can see the numbers. Okay, here we go. And ending it now. And now. Okay, let me show the results so you can see them. I think you can see it. Can you see it? Y'all can see it? Okay. So those are the numbers. Now here's the reason we do that as a starter, just to kind of like help us land into, sometimes when you ask people how they're doing, there's already a prepared answer. How you doing? I'm good, I'm cool, I'm fine, I'm okay. I'm great, never been better. Whatever the answer you normally give, the question I want to invite you to ask yourself is that the real answer? Is that how you really feel? Where do we get to be not fully okay, to be not good? Us as the people doing a lot of this work to serve our community, to serve others, where do we get a place to be like, yeah, you know, I just want to lay on the floor right now and just maybe cry. Maybe throw out some emotions, maybe just stretch out and like go to sleep for 10 hours. What would it be like if we could have a place? And I hope each of you have that. And we're going to talk more about that in a second. So thank you for, you already saw the results. I'm not sure how to close this, but I think we'll close the poll so you get it out of your way. See if I click that. That's already done. Okay, I'll stop sharing that. You already saw it, right? You all can see the results, yeah? You saw the results? Okay, great. It's almost. I see what it's doing. I'm just close it. I think it'll be done. Okay, cool. Take a deep breath. There's a song that we play in this work. There's a song by Matthew West. And I think that it may help us to ground in to kind of what we're going to talk about today. So let me just play that song. I didn't know if I was going to play it, but something told me to play it. So let's let this song play. We're going to listen like 1 minute of this song. If you haven't heard of it, hopefully something in it resonates. Here we go.
Lie number one, you're supposed to have it all together. And when they ask how you're doing, just smile and tell them, never better. Lie number two, everybody's life is perfect except yours. So keep your messes and your wounds and your secrets safe with you behind closed doors. Truth be told, the truth is rarely told. I say I'm fine, yeah, I'm fine, oh, I'm fine, hey, I'm fine, but I'm not. I'm broken, and when it's out of control, I say it's under control, but it's not. And you know it, I don't know why it's so hard to admit it, when being honest is the only way to feel. There's no failure, no fall, there's no sin you don't already know. So let the truth be told.
So let the truth be told. Truth be told, that I work with a lot of young people in our community who are keeping everything to themselves, who they got good masks. Now, I'm not talking about our personal protection masks. I'm talking about these masks of emotional disconnection where they say, I'm a 10, Branch. Dude, I'm doing great. Everything's fine. Sometimes they're good at it. Sometimes they're good and they got me. They fool me. And I'm like, all right, well, are you sure? Yeah, everything's good. I'm good. 3 weeks later, I find out they were sleeping on their cousin's couch because I'm like, why didn't you tell me? We were just talking 2 weeks ago. Well, you know, I don't want to make you worry about my stuff. I'm like, I checked in with you because I cared. Even sometimes when we have people who want to be there for us, we may overthink it for them. What I see with the young people in our work who don't want to tell you what they're really going through because they think they're going to burden you. And I'm telling them, like, let me carry it with you. I'm not here to fix it necessarily, but I am here to let you know that you don't have to carry it by yourself. What does that look like? I heard a young man say the other day, well, why should I talk about it if you can't fix it? Because in his mind, the only reason you should talk about it is if somebody can fix it. If no one can fix it, then you don't need to talk about it. And what happens with that process? Well, we store it all inside. It gets stored up in certain places. Maybe it gets stored up in healthy places. Maybe you go to start running in athletics, some athleticism, maybe you begin to store it in places that begin to hurt your body, your mind. Maybe you begin to self-medicate the thing that you're not dealing with. So then you just keep covering it up and covering it up and covering it up with more Band-Aids. It doesn't get to heal. And so in this work, what I've been trying to do over the years is give young people a space to say, we got to have a safe space to talk about it. If we don't have a safe space to talk about it, you're going to deal with it your own way, which is what we have to do as humans. We have to deal with things our own way, the way we learned. And maybe some of those ways of the way we learned were helpful, and maybe sometimes they were not. I'm going to jump in, and we're going to do a breakout. Actually, I think we're going to do a breakout. Let's start right here with a breakout, I think. So I think it'll be good for, as this check-in is happening, to give each of you a chance just to kind of like ground in. So what I'm going to do is we're going to do this first breakout. It's going to be, you're going to get 2 minutes each. And the way it works with us in breakouts, I just really want you to make sure someone in the room is a timekeeper. Because sometimes we get excited and we get going and then we lose time for everyone else. So just be really mindful that you're going to get 2 minutes each. And let's say that in your 2 minute share, that you finish at 1 minute, then what the circle does for you is we just wait in silence. We just give you your full 2 minutes just to be heard. And even if that means that the silence, then we hold that 2 minutes for you as a way of just respecting your time. So you don't have to fill up the whole 2 minutes, but you can. And we ask that if you fill up the 2 minutes, that you kind of cut it right at 2 minutes. Once the timer goes off, please, so the next person can go. And then when we bring you back, everyone had a chance to share. And I think it's just what I wanted you to think about in this breakout is just, let's do a check-in like this. Let's call it a rose, a thorn, and a bud. A rose, a thorn, and a bud. Rose, something that's going well, something that's working really beautifully in your life. A thorn, maybe something that's not going so well, that's maybe challenging. It doesn't have to be bad. You know, thorns are needed for roses, right? That protects them from the animals who may want to eat them, right? But it's not necessarily bad. It's just something that may be a little prickly, challenging. And a bud is something that you're looking forward to, something that you're excited, maybe this weekend, maybe next week, maybe in December, whatever it is, something you're looking forward to. So if you can do that in that 2 minutes, just to kind of connect, and this is going to be the group you're going to be with when we come back again to break out groups in a minute. If we can start there, I think that'll be helpful for this this piece. So you're going to have 2 minutes each. If you can have a timekeeper in the room, and then we'll see you back here in about, it's going to be groups of four. So you'll have about 8 minutes each. Okay. All right. See you in a little bit. Thank you so much. Welcome back. Maybe in the chat, or I'd like to hear from a couple of voices out loud, but maybe for those, in the chat, if you can just write, how was that? How was that experience just having 2 minutes to yourself to process how you wanted to process, to talk about maybe a prompt or not the prompt, whatever you used as your 2 minutes. Maybe let me hear from maybe three or four people out loud if you're willing. How was that?
Feel free to unmute yourself.
So someone in the chat said, very beneficial for me. Thank you. Thank you, Shimerly. It was nice to connect with people. Thank you, Paula. It was great. Dayan, hope I pronounced that right. Nice to feel heard. Michelle. If I pronounce it wrong, you can tell me. I won't be offended. I want to do it right. Well, this is what we do. Thank you. And if no one's ready to talk out loud, we're okay. What we're gonna do is jump into the work. So thank you for taking that moment to just be present and to take your 2 minutes. And you know, I wish we could do it more often. I wish we could find people who would just let us be able to talk for 2 minutes without interrupting and not adding their thoughts or their questions and their stuff, and let us just talk about what we want to talk about. I think it's important. And so we're going to have another one toward in maybe a half hour in the breakout room. So, and it may be a deeper question, but thank you for doing your best there. All right. So in this work that we're going to be talking about around this unmasking healthy relationships, it's connected to how we and Ever Forward first started. I was not ever planning to be a teacher or an educator, or definitely not run around nonprofit. I wanted to be rich. That was my plan. Like I grew up, I was raised by a single mother in Oakland. My father died before I was born. There's a book I'm reading. Is it here? I think it's here. It's somewhere close by. It's called It Didn't Start With You. And in this book, it talks about how childhood trauma kind of carries with us in our lives. And sometimes we may not even understand where it all came from. But here's what I understand a little bit more as I've researched. My father died 3 months before I was born. My mom did the best she could, but my mom wasn't necessarily a man. So she didn't know how to teach me how to be a man. She only knew how to support me in like clean the house. She told me how to cook really good. Like I was very well, I was domesticated. At 7 years old, I was told I was the man of the house by my uncle. My uncle said, Ashanti, you got to take care of your mom and your sister and your brother. And I was like, uncle, I don't want this job. Can you find the man who's supposed to be doing this job? Because I just want to go outside and play. And it wasn't like it was an option. It wasn't like it was an opportunity for personal development. It was like, hey, Ashanti, you got to take charge of this house and take care of everybody. So at 7 years old, my journey of taking care of others began. And so when I talk about that idea of feeling like you have to take care of others, I don't really think I had a childhood if I could describe it. I was a child, but I was operating as a very responsible child who had kids who I was taking care of and feeding and changing and diapers and bottles and baths and homework. And all of that stuff is a part of my growing up. The reason I start with that part is because in this book, it talks about how things that happened before we may have even been born may show up in our life. Well, in this book, when my father died, my mom was really sad. My mom really loved my dad, and my dad loved my mom. And so in this womb, for 3 months, I was swimming in grief. I was swimming in sadness. I was swimming in an emotional womb, if you're going to call it that way. And I showed up on the planet, a very emotional little boy. But I was told that, dude, stop crying. Suck it up. Man up. Stop being a little sissy. Stop being a little wuss. That's all the names that maybe in your community they would call boys who were sensitive, because I was sensitive. And why? Well, what I'm learning is that in that womb, all of the DNA, all of the genes that were passed into me of my mom crying for weeks and weeks and weeks, now having to figure out how to raise this boy by herself, with the love of her life dying. Like how do you translate that to what happens to me being very emotional? Well, I was told you're not supposed to feel those things. Suck it up. Boys don't cry, men don't cry. So 7 years old, having to be the man of the house, I had to shut down emotions because they weren't cool, they weren't tough, they weren't manly, they were what my community told me, what my people in my life told me, hey, you can't be doing that. And so I learned how to shut them down really, really good. And so when I was thinking about what I wanted to do in my life, well, I saw rich people being powerful. I knew poor wasn't fun because we were poor. We were on food stamps. I hated going into the store with food stamps. And for those who don't know what I'm talking about like Monopoly money. Imagine if you had to go to the store with Monopoly money and like everyone in the line behind you know that you're poor because your money has like, it's like orange and purple and green. Like it's not green money green, it's some other green. It's like the green you shouldn't be handing a cashier, but it was fake money. That's what we were living off of. And I was like, this ain't fun. I don't want this. So they told me that if you go to college and you study hard, you get a good job, you can make a lot of money, you can live happily ever after. I'm like, say that again. He said, you study hard, you go to college, get a good job, make a lot of money, you can live happily ever after. I'm like, sign me up for happily ever after. So I worked hard. I was going to college. I went to college. I graduated in engineering. And I was going to be rich. This is my mom. I'm thankful to still have her in my life. I didn't like her a lot growing up, but I love her. she drove me nuts sometimes. This is my grandmother. This is my father's mother. My father died before I was born. So she was the only connection to the branch side of my life. My grandmother was the kind of grandmother, she'd be like, go outside and play all the time. Whether I was 5 years old or 25 years old, go outside and play. So I'm asking all these questions. So like my grandmother never wanted you to ask no questions. And finally around 2010, this is like one of the last times I got her to leave her house. I said, grandmother, you got to tell me about my family. I don't know anything about branch. I knew my mom's side of the family. I didn't know anything about, all I knew was her. She was kind of like the gatekeeper. And she finally opened the door so I could meet the rest of the branch family, which there are many of them out there that I had never known. And she had blocked that door. But I think she knew she was coming close to the end. My grandmother, I lost my grandmother last year at the beginning in January before COVID, which was really tough. But part of me was like, well, maybe it's better it happened then. You know, she was 98 years old. She lived a full life and I miss her. This is me in college. This is me on my journey to being rich. So these are some of my best friends in college. These are all other engineering majors. We're all studying different things, but these are some of the men who helped me get through college. Because college was hard. As much as I think I was smart and I worked hard, it was still tough living in San Luis Obispo, California, where there's only 1 hour of hip hop radio per week. Sunday night at 7 p.m. Smooth grooves. I don't know what they call it. It was only 1 hour a week. You got some hometown music. The rest of the week, it was something else. But this is how I was able to survive on this journey to being rich because they said it was going to take hard work. Now, mind you, this journey of me trying to go off and be rich, but then find myself in India, Tamil Nadu, Southeast India, teaching math. Hey, wait, what's happening, Ashanti? You were on this journey to become rich and you find yourself teaching math in Southeast India. Something has changed. The journey has changed. Anybody found their journey in life change? Maybe you planned the change. Maybe the change kind of happened and you looked up. You're like, well, how did I end up over here? How did I end up in Southeast India hot? I mean, I'm talking about hot. I'm talking about, I can't even describe the hot. Let me just say, I got off the plane in July. And I didn't stop sweating until I got back home in February of the next year. Like I was sweating every day. That's another story, but just to let you know, it's hot, okay? And so these are my students. These are my students. And what I learned from these students was what it meant for students to be hungry for education. And when I saw that, and the first day it happened, a student came up to me, Paranita, the class leader. She said, sir, I want to introduce you to the class topper. Now, class topper, I'm teaching math, right? So the teachers don't stay in the classroom. Students stay in the classroom. So I go from class to class. Students, they own the rooms. That's how it works. So I go into class and she says, I want to introduce you to the class topper. Now, I don't know what a class topper is. I never heard of that. And he stands up and the class erupts in cheers. Now, here's the class topper is. A class topper is the student who got the highest score on the last math test. What? You mean you're cheering for the kid who got the highest score on a math test? Do you know how many math tests I hid in the bottom of my backpack? I didn't want my friends to see that I was getting good scores because they weren't. And I didn't want to make them feel bad. So I hid my test. You know how many times I did that? Countless times. You know how many times friends would be like, give me an answer. And I'm like, you're not getting me in trouble. And then I'm like, hi, pretending like I don't know the answer. I don't know how to do it. And then I get, you know, it's a battle sometimes. But let me move on, because we were going to jump into the work. These are those students now, you know, what, that was 2007 when I was in India. This is 13 years later. They're now all over the world. They're doctors, engineers, doing amazing things. To be able to reconnect in that journey of like, how did I end up here when it wasn't my plan? My plan was to have a big house in Oakland Hills and be looking down at Oakland, like, look at me, you know what I mean? Like, that was my plan. And I live in the heartland, right? I live in the heartland. And I think back to like how the journey all happened. Maybe you can think about your journey. The work that we're going to do right now has, without my plan, me becoming a teacher and following my heart to this work, or how the work came to me, has taken me into lots of parts of the world to be able to share it. And what I'm going to share with you today. And so I'm going to go through this pretty fast, but I just want you to know that I didn't plan this. I didn't plan this. Let me create something that I can go and do all over the world. I left an engineering career trying to give back to my community. And that work of just following my heart one step at a time, sometimes rough steps, but has taken me to different parts of the world. So the work that we get to, that you're going to experience right now, is work that I think called me. It's not work that I really planned. And it started off with me being a very bad teacher. I had smart kids failing my class. To share with you, when I was a first year teacher and I was doing a really horrible job, I felt this was how I began to kind of reconnect with students. I was thinking, well, I was teaching at San Lorenzo High School here in the Bay Area. So San Lorenzo High School was my first job teaching. I'm a first year teacher, like coming from the engineering career. And I'm like doing a horrible job. And I'm like, well, look, I'm not going to be here and fail. Look, I accepted that me becoming a teacher I was going to be financially broke. How about that? That's my mom, the language my mom used, broke. You know, you're going to be broke. And my mom was a teacher. So she knew when I told her I was leaving engineering, she didn't tell me not to. She said, well, you know, you're going to be broke because you've been traveling all over the world. You think you ain't going to do that as no teacher. And I was like, yeah, I know. And so I was like, well, let me try something new. And so this is what I tried. I said, well, look, when I was in corporate America, I had as a coach. So let me try and do some coach stuff with these students. I told the students, I'm not going to be your teacher no more. From now on, I'm going to be your coach. And so I used these questions that I got from one of my coaches, and I made it for my students. I was like, okay, we're going to bring coaching into classrooms. That's what we're going to do. And you can see I signed it, success coach at the bottom. I was like, I'm going to be your support coach. That's how we're going to do this. And so let me have you try this first. If you can just think about this, you can just think about it to yourself. What is an obstacle that you have overcome? Maybe you can think about yourself as a teenager, or you can think about yourself the age of some of your clients that you work with, or you can think about whatever age and journey along the journey. Think of an obstacle you'd overcome. And then think about an obstacle that you were currently facing, right? So knowing that, you know, we overcome obstacles and maybe new obstacles come, right? Just part of life, of just figuring out how to navigate different types of obstacles, different seasons of our life, yeah? So I'm going to show you what some of the young people said in our work. Some of the young people said, and this is just a couple of them. Obstacles that I overcome in my life is drugs and my girlfriend. That's one young man. Obstacles that I currently face are some teachers being boring, like my English class. What? I identify with this young man. Like, I don't like English either. Imagine that. The next one. Obstacles that I overcome in my life. I almost overcome gangs and stuff like that. He could have just put, I overcome them. He didn't have to put almost. You can see almost kind of slipped in there, yeah? Obstacles that I currently face are their gangs. I didn't know this about that young man. Obstacles that I overcome in my life is the fact that my dad is not with me no more, and I had to accept it now. Obstacles that I currently face are school and how bad I want to do good in school, but I always end up slacking off. This young man witnessed his father dying. I didn't know that about this young man. I knew he came to class, did nothing every day. He was there every day on time. Did no work ever. He thinks he's slacking off because that's what his family's telling him. You're slacking off. But he just keeps replaying this image in his head because his family doesn't know what therapy is. His family doesn't know what post-traumatic stress is. His family doesn't know that he just needs to talk to somebody about what he's talking about because he's been told he ain't supposed to feel what he's feeling. And this last one here, I was irritated first. It was so small. That's to be honest, let me tell you. And I was going to hand it back to the young man. I was like, man, don't hand me no half-filled boxes. but something told me just to keep it, and I took it. And that's what it said when I read it. It says, obstacle that I overcome was just make it to the age I am. He's a freshman in high school, 13, maybe 14. He's saying, look, I'm just glad to be alive right now. And the goal, obstacle he currently faced, was passing this math class. I could have bet you, if any kind of amount of money, that this kid didn't care about passing my class. This is not the answer I expected to hear from him. But here's what I also realized. This young man came to class every day late. Every day after this, when I read this, every day he came to class, I gave him a high five. Dude, I'm so glad you're here today. And then I would say, stop being late. Because it's never okay to be late. But let me first honor you for being here. If you're just glad to be alive, let me just honor you that you showed up to my class. And then we can deal with the tardy stuff soon, you know? But let me just give you credit for just the fact that you're glad to be alive still. This is the work. Some of our work was helping young people see past what they can only see for themselves. And so I tried to do these letters back and forth. I'm gonna write letters to students every day. Now I want you to try something, and I couldn't write, I'm talking about the letters. I thought I was gonna write students back and forth letters every week, but I don't like to write that much, first of all. And I have 150 students, second of all. And I'm a math teacher, third of all. So first of all, it was like, how do I keep up with all this? I started on a movie. I thought, hey, maybe if I do this, they'll make a movie about me, right? But that it didn't work that way. 150 letters a week is a lot of writing. And I couldn't keep up with it. So I want you to try something. I'm gonna show it to you first. I would like you to say out loud to yourself, or if you're not in a place you can say out loud, say it in your mind. But I want you to say, I am, three times. I am, okay? Now, what I would like you to do is I would like you to pick one of these words to say after each I am. Now, you can pick the same word three times. You can pick three different words. You can pick two and one, whatever you feel. Pick a word and say it after I am. So I am amazing. I am awesome. I am creative. And what I'd like you to do while you're thinking about saying that, or if you're resisting it in any way, ask yourself what you feel about what I'm asking you to do. Maybe you might be saying, this is silly. I ain't doing no affirmation mumbo jumbo. I ain't got time for this. I need to be learning about these my clients. How am I going to help my client? Like, maybe you're right. Maybe you feel resistance. You know why I can name the resistance? Because when my mentor said to me to do this task, I'm like, dude, I got time for this. Why are we doing this? You should be helping me figure out how to keep this organization going through this pandemic. I ain't got time to be doing no positive affirmation mumbo jumbo. I use mumbo jumbo with him, which is why I know that phrase. And he said, Ashanti, just do it. It's easy. I'm like, yeah, I don't care about it being easy. Why are we wasting time doing this? I ain't got time for this. And this is what he said next. He said, Ashanti, do you believe it? Oh, I don't like him sometimes. Do you believe it? Why was it so difficult for me to say these words about myself? Well, it's because, if truth be told, when I look at myself in the mirror, this is not how I describe myself. Like, I am the best at affirming the young people in my program. I tell them these words about them, you are, all the time. But when he turned this thing around on me, it tapped into a part where I was like, why am I having a hard time doing this? Why am I resisting something so simple? What if you didn't grow up hearing these kind of things about yourself? I know my mom loved me. Well, she paid the bills, right? We had a house. We didn't have a house. We had apartments, but we had a place to live, put it that way. They weren't always nice places to live, but we had a place to live. We always had at least some top ramen in there, some peanut butter and jelly sandwich. Like, we always had something. She did the best she could. So I know she loved me, but she didn't walk around the house telling me, Ashanti, you're amazing. Ashanti, you're so awesome. Maybe you get one of those on your birthday. Maybe you get one of those if you get a good report card. But it was always based on your doing, not your being. If you did something, awesome. Then I'm gonna give you a little credit, but you don't get credit for stuff you're already supposed to do. So therefore, if you'd never heard that you were amazing or awesome or special, maybe you wouldn't even believe it when the person who finally came to love you in life loves you and said, I think you're amazing. You may resist against hearing it. You may fight against them telling you it. If it's maybe hard to believe it yourself. And so the reason I asked you to do this right now is because the work that we've done in our work is trying to give young people space to first affirm them or their own selves. And the reason I know it's difficult because it's difficult for me. And so my job is to help them borrow some of my belief in them, borrow some of what I see in them until they can grab some of their own and then begin seeing it in themselves. That's our work. And maybe as you think about the people you work with, your clients, your team, your staff, your whether you're leading people or you're supporting people or you're helping people, however those levels are, maybe when you ask people how they're doing and they say fine, maybe they are doing fine. Maybe they're doing great. Or maybe they don't know that you can handle if they told you how much they were really going through. I don't know. I'm going to move through this. I think you're ready. I'm going to tell you this last part about Ever Forward Club, and then we're going to jump into the work. I think we're ready to do the work. I want to just kind of give you an overview of kind of how this all started, because I didn't start this with trying to be like, let me go teach people about these emotions and masks. No, I was a teacher trying to support some young men who were really smart, who were not doing good academically, because, you know, schools measure you by how well you do academically. They don't care if you take care of family members at home. They don't care if you are translate for your family to keep everything moving in life. They don't care if you can raise children. They don't care if you take care of elderly people in your family. They care if you can get good points on a test, therefore getting good grades, therefore being a good student. Now, when I say those schools, you may have definitely teachers who are out there who are affirming kids in other ways, but I'm talking about the system of schooling. The system of schooling is really about, can you do the work? And so these are the first young men Ever Forward. It's great to be still part of many of their lives. One of them is a teacher, Corbray right here. I'm trying to describe him. He's in the bottom row, African-American young man on the black sweater. He's a teacher in Oakland now. So we got one teacher in the crew, and it's beautiful. To see this and see this journey from 2004. This is 2004. This is my classroom. You can see my classroom. My wall behind me was places I had traveled when I was an engineer still, because I had money then. So it was like my moment of like, oh, you know, just get back to it. But this became my new world and my new life, these young men. And so I'm going to tell you two stories of a young man, and then we're going to do the work. I said we're going to do the work, but I want you to hear this. This is an avatar of a young man in my work. This is two different texts from this young man. And this is our conversation, because sometimes the young people in our work will run away. When I say run away, I mean like they will stop returning calls. They will stop answering my texts. They will, what they call it, I guess they'll ghost me, whatever they call it. But what they do is they know they're good at it. And so the way it works is, it says here, why do I run? This is him writing to me. Because I asked him, dude, why are you running? I'm trying to support you. Why do you keep running away? He says, and why do you keep trying to help me? It's so confusing and it hurts me to run from you, but I feel like you shouldn't be doing this for me. Why are you there for me when my own blood won't move a finger? It's confusing. I don't have anything but love for you, Branch. Thank you. This young man has told himself a story that if his family's not there for him, then therefore no one else should be. Because he's bought the after school specials that the family does all the loving and caring for you. And when the family doesn't do it, maybe you're not worthy of it. And I don't have an answer. I don't know how. I told him, I don't know how we got connected, but ultimately I'm here for you, but I can't make you believe anything you don't want to believe. Like, and then this next text is about a year later. He was on another running spree, but I was just like reaching out. It was Christmas Day. And I said, Merry Christmas. I'm sad that I don't get to see you anymore, but I respect your choices. I've been here for you, regardless of what story you're telling yourself. I'm still here for you. And he replied back a couple of hours, maybe an hour later. He said, just want to wish you a happy new year. Hope everything goes well for you and you reach all your goals. Just know I have nothing against you. I'm in a crazy place in my life. I don't want you to hurt over me. I'm a horrible person, You don't need me in your life. I need you, but I'm choosing to keep my distance because the only one who will be hurt at the end from this friendship is you. I love you, Branch. Stay safe. Listen, all I know is that by the time he wrote back, I was already asleep. So when I got the next morning, I wrote this, and it took us several more months before I could finally get him face to face. But what is it when you believe that no one can handle what you're going through? No one would be able to listen to it and stay there. So it's better to keep people away so that you don't have to lose them. You can just kind of keep them in limbo. And this is story after story of young men, but I want you to know that young man, it means a lot to me. This photo is Yosemite 2019 summer. The young man standing next to me is CJ, and he is a great young man. We went to Yosemite. I wasn't planning to go on this trip, just so you know. You ever been signed up for something that you didn't really want to go to? A conference, workshop, plan, meeting? Like, I tried to hire somebody else to go to Yosemite. Like, I was not physically, mentally prepared to hike 25 miles in the backcountry with a 70-pound backpack. I was not prepared. But since no one else wanted to go, and since I'm in charge, guess what? I had to go. So all these smiles you see were not smiles like 5-10 minutes before we came out of the backcountry. This is our first picture outside of the backcountry. They were not smiles a few minutes ago. And if you saw their faces on this picture, they were not smiles. But what we are is we're in the backcountry. We are in the tree forest in Yosemite. And the young man who I mentioned, he said something really amazing when we walked through this little tree cemetery. That's what they call it. He said, look at the beauty in dead things. Look at the beauty in dead things. And hearing it from him is actually pretty telling, because when he left eighth grade to go to high school, he lost his mom. And he was raised by a single mother. He's a mama's boy. Just like I was. I know how close he was to her and how much she loved him. And that moment, I just remember I saw it on Facebook, and I reached out, called right away. I called the grandmother, and he didn't want to talk. He wouldn't talk. He kind of shut down for several months. And I just kept calling. He would be like one word answers. I say, hey man, how you doing? How's it going? Fine. Good. Cool. I'm all right. I'm like, well, I'm here for you if you want to talk. All right. Okay. And then would hang up. It would be a 30-second phone call every time. It would be one-sided. So I just thought I would just let him know I was still there. What if after 1 month of me calling him every week and him not answering, I just say, you know what? I tried. I'm done. I mean, I was tempted sometimes, but I knew that my job was in that moment not to be in control. My job was to be there as a support. And therefore, it took him a while before he finally came out, and he reached out one day on his own. He called and he said, hey, Branch, what are you doing? I don't know what I was doing, but I said nothing. And we got together, and he finally got a chance to like begin to like process what he was going through. That pain, that sadness, that worry, that fear, that what do you do? Now, he just finished his freshman year in college, and right before his freshman year in college, he also lost his grandmother. And this time he called me. I knew she was not doing well, and he called me. And one of the questions he asked was, why does this keep happening to me? I mean, what do you do when somebody you really care about and you want to support? Like I'm his mentor. I don't get paid to work with him. I just love him. But what do you do when you don't have an answer? I don't have an answer for that question. I just said, brother, I don't have an answer for that. That's all I could say. And I said, but I'm here for you. I'm here to help you navigate this. What do you do 18 years old when you inherit a house and three cars and a mortgage and responsibilities? And what do you do that you are now responsible for all this stuff? I think sometimes things happen to us. We don't get to answer why and how, but we ultimately have part of the responsibility to figure it out. There's a quote by Mark Brackett. When we ignore our feelings or suppress them, they only become stronger. If we don't express our emotions, they pile up like a debt that will eventually come due. And so that's where I want to stop with storytelling pieces. I just want you to know that what we're going to do right now, this activity, wasn't because I just was trying to make up activities. It was a journey of working with young men from 2004 till today and finding a way to help them process what am I dealing with? What am I not dealing with? What am I not talking about? What don't I have a place to talk about things that I'm going through? And so what we're going to do right now is I'm going to give you a link in the chat, okay? And I'm going to ask you to go to this link in the chat. And what you're going to do is we're going to do this activity virtually. So you're going to, it's an anonymous activity. Let me pull it up right quick. Sorry. This is the activity that I told you that we created that featured our work in the documentary, The Mask You Live In. And what I'm going to ask you to do is when you click on that link, it's going to open up a site. And there's going to be a button that says, draw your mask. So if you're on a phone, when you click it, maybe a red button. I think it's also red if you're on your computer. It will say, draw your mask. And if you click on that button to draw your mask, it'll bring up another screen which has some instructions. You can just click skip on the bottom of that screen, click skip, and I'm going to walk you through the steps. This activity that I'm going to ask you to do is really simple, but it may not be easy. All right, so it's a simple task. We're just going to draw one picture and write 6 words on the screen. And there's no grade and it's anonymous, right? So it's a simple task, but it may not be easy. So I just ask you just to give your best from wherever you are right now, okay? So here's what I have you do. If you look at the left side of the postcard image looking thing there, it says front of the mask. So I want you to think about, what are masks in our lives? Now, we started this campaign back in 2016, so this is before we're wearing masks, these personal protection masks. But I want you to think of masks that are not those type of masks, but masks that were existing in our lives and our world before. So the first step is to, on the left side, where it says front of mask, to draw a mask. So you can change the colors at the top. You can change the size of the pen you're writing with. You can use different shades. You can use a crayon or a marker, whatever you want to use there. I'm gonna give you about 2 minutes to draw a mask. I'll play a song. And then after you draw the mask, there's 2 questions at the bottom I want you to answer. You're going to type the answers in the box, and those answers will pop up to the top, okay? So let me give you 2 minutes first to just draw your mask. And then we'll come back. If you move really fast and you finish already, after you answer the 2 questions, click submit. It's going to ask you for 3 pieces of information: age, city, and gender. If you don't want to put your city, it's not really trying to figure out who you are, but it just helps us know. Just put first 5. You don't need to put your city. It just helps us kind of locate, because we have masks from all over the world. It helps us just kind of locate where masks are coming from. So no need to put your own city. You can just put first 5 and we'll know that it came from the first 5 workshop, okay? All right, so I'm gonna get some music playing. Go ahead and start drawing. If you have any questions, you can unmute yourself and ask. And we'll be back in 2 minutes to give you the next step, okay? All right, here we go. So right about now, if you are finished drawing your mask, I want you to go ahead and start moving to the questions. Think of 3 words for the front of the mask, which is the left side, which are qualities of yourself that you gladly let the world see, okay? And then I want you to think of the back of the mask, which are things that you normally don't let people see, things you don't normally talk about. Maybe for lots of reasons, maybe because no one ever asks, maybe it just never comes up, maybe you just don't think about talking about it, or maybe there are things that you just have chosen not to talk about, but you decide which 3 feel right for you to share there. And once you put the words, you type them in the box, you'll see the words will move up to the top. And if you know they happen to move up over your picture, you can just drag the word somewhere else just to make room for it. But after you do that, you can click submit in the top right corner after you put those words down. And answer those 3 questions if you're willing. There's no teacher code. You don't need to put a teacher code there. And then click submit. And once you finish submitting, if you can just write done in the chat, it'll let us know when most people are done. And I'm going to kind of just gauge. I'm going to give you about another 2 minutes. Maybe I'll say about a minute and a half. I'll show you a video right now. But if you can finish up that part. And if you find yourself stuck on the back, I feel like, well, I don't know what to write here. Just maybe like, I can only think of 1. Then just write that. Just do your best, whatever you can. And I'll finish playing the rest of the song. And then I'll come back and I'll show you a video. But if you can write done in the chat, it'll help us know when most people are done. And I don't want to cover up the screen if you're still working. Okay. So here we go. Where you're at, you know that I got your back. As your friend, I will go with you no matter where or how far. Cause I know your truth. I love who you are. I'll be around even when you don't see me. I'm not afraid to get teased, even if it means standing up for you when they say those hateful things. Oh, they're not true. They're not true. Hearts beat louder, voices rising. I'll be there for you, always riding side by side, listening out. I need you, standing beside you, holding you up when you falling apart and you can't get up. You know you will be alright, cause you know that I got you. You are not alone.
Pleased to meet you, me, I'm me, who are you? Let's take a tour of it, top of the class, clever the boo, swish on your shoe, it's a good look when you wear what you wanna wear, there's a unique flair to your hair, you're so pretty and so debonair, you're a beautiful soul to be shared.
Be,
who you wanna be, who you wanna see when you walk down the street?
Be,
who you wanna be, who you think of and it makes you feel free?
Be,
who you wanna be, and it makes you feel good when you think that's me?
Be,
who you wanna be, all you gotta do, really, really, you'll see, yeah.
Who you wanna be, just gotta be me.
So the songs you were hearing is by a local group called Alphabet Rockers. They're from Oakland. They do a lot of work around equity, connection, building community. And that was their last album called The Love. So if you like those songs, that's the Alphabet Rockers. And one of our work is featured in one of their songs around masks. And so that's really exciting part of our work. So I see several people have written done, and if you have not yet, go ahead and write done in the chat. And if you are if you're not gonna do it, just write done anyway, so at least I know that you're kind of done. And then I'm gonna show you a video, and the video I want to show you is a collection of masks from around the world. We have this movement is called the Million Mask Movement, and we've collected masks from over 40 countries around the world, over 50,000 masks. And what you're going to see is a collection of a few masks that we have, and you'll hear a song that was made by a group of high school students called High School for Recording Arts. And so when you watch these masks, just take an inventory about what you see, what you notice, what are you feeling? What was it like when you were making your mask? What are you thinking about right now as you're thinking about the mask you just made or the mask you're making? But I'm gonna go ahead and play this video right now, and here we go.
So much you'll never have until you ask. You don't know just who I am under this mask. 100,000 masks, I'm just trying to be a man. 100,000 masks, you don't know just who I am. May think you know me, you can't envision my past. You don't know just who I am under this mask. 100,000 masks, I'm just trying to be a man. 100,000 masks, you don't know just who I am. Walk 1,000 miles and I ain't never looking back. Before I take this mask off, gotta know myself in fact. I can never go too fast, I can never get off track. Leave it in the past, I can never come in last. 100,000 masks, sure I feel who I am. I'm just feeling good, yeah, I'm feeling like the man. Front and back of masks, tryna ask of who I am. Know just who I am, when you look inside this mask. Some of you'll never have, until you ask. You don't know just who I am under this mask. 100,000 masks, I'm just trying to be a man. 100,000 masks, you don't know just who I am. may think you know me, you can't envision my past. You don't know just who I am under this mask. 100,000 masks, I'm just trying to be a man. 100,000 masks, you don't know just who I am.
So now I'm actually going to take a deep breath. And I'd like you just to, in the chat or out loud, you can just share how you're feeling right now. How are you feeling? What did you notice? What did you see in the video? What did you think about when you made your own mask? It's kind of really open-ended, but what did you notice coming up for you? What stood out to you? Wherever you are right now, if you're willing to share, and you can do it in the chat, or you can do it, in out here in the room. So just unmute yourself and speak, or you can put it in the chat, whatever you're feeling comfortable to do right now. Some of the comments that are coming in, and when you're ready to speak, just start speaking, and I'll stop. Emotional, sad for all the young people who are feeling hopeless and not able to accept help or ask for help. Raw. People hide their bad feelings. Very few people reveal their true selves. So much suffering. There's a phrase in the song that says, "You don't know who I am." How much people truly hide their true feelings and fears. Beautiful experience to see this vulnerability. Thank you. I should probably give credit to the people who are saying those things. That was Theon, Carla, Celia, Brenda, Beth, Michelle, Renee said, beautiful experience. Kimberly, empowered. Vina, it was powerful to see the shared feelings, the pain, sadness. Beth said, we are all alone together. Celia said, some people keep their feelings inside. Yeah, Vina, also a reminder of what we share and keep inside that we don't. Yeah. Kamika, we have very similar masks, no matter the age. We all need a way to heal. Yeah, thank you. Michelle said, I'm gonna say both every time, I'm not sure. We don't always see people. Yeah. We see the outside, right? We see what they let us see on the outside. We have no idea what's going on with people on the inside. If you look at somebody, you describe them on the outside, you can 10 characteristics, hair color, eye color, shape, face, blah, 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 body size. But then what do you not know? So many things. And sometimes we use the outside to judge what people are, who they are, right? So many things we miss. Yeah, Paula, I said, I pray there'll be more people like you who, oh, wow. Okay, I don't know. Thank you. I'm reading a comment about myself. Create a space and moment for our children and for us to express our feelings and unfolding our true mask. Thank you. Thank you. The mask we wear. So here's what I want to do. This is the work that we have created. And maybe this will be a way I'm going to show you how I think this work can support you in your work, but also just in how you begin to use this. And so this tool we created for people to use, I'm gonna pull it up on Safari because I can show it to you. I'm gonna show you how you can create your own account there. So let me do this. We have the new version of this tool that is available, but I wanna show you how we have been able to use it so far. But I'm gonna put you in, actually, you know what, before I do that, because that's gonna get into logistics, I'm gonna put you into a breakout room. I think there probably needs to be some more time for reflect. So let's do the breakout room now. So you'll get, same 2 minutes each. If if you decide that as a group you want to go, you know, 1-1-1-1 and then have another round of 1-1-1, do that. But 2 minutes each is the ideal. But this conversation probably is a little bit more, you know, more vibrant in the way. I would like you to just, if you're able in the prompt, to think about what you want to say. I think let's do it like that. I would like you to just, if you can reflect to this prompt when you speak, and we'll do like a 1 minute each, and then we'll come back around. So you'll keep your time, or you can do 2 minutes, however you want to do it there. My mind is kind of going back and forth between giving you more time each, but I'll let you all decide when you get into that circle. But here's what I want you to do. I want you to start by saying, you can't tell by looking at me. You can't tell by looking at me. So let's do that for 1 minute each. And then the second minute will be an opportunity just to reflect out loud with each other. So that 1 minute, just start with that prompt each time. You can't tell by looking at me. Like, you can't tell. If I was going to go and I was like, I don't know these people, I ain't about to tell them nothing about myself, maybe I would say something like, you can't tell by looking at me that I speak Spanish. Like, I don't think you would know that. It's true. And I don't feel like I've hurt myself by telling you that, right? You can't tell by looking at me that I'm a mama's boy, yeah? You can't tell by looking at me that my mom is trying to show me where all her important papers are, and I don't want to see them. I don't even want to talk about it. You can't tell by looking at me that even thinking about that is hard for me. So you decide what it is you are willing to share with that space. And if you have your 1 minute, and then you all can go back and really connect after that around this whole experience. And so we'll give you 2 minutes each, but you'll do 1 minute first and then another minute. And hopefully, I think most people are still here. So in those breakouts, you can take that time, and then we'll come back, and then I'll show you this tool, and we'll do some questions, and then I'll show you some more pieces of the work that we're doing. Okay. So here we go. We're going to go into the breakout rooms. You can't tell by looking at me. We'll type it in the chat so that you can see it there. And we'll see you in a few minutes. Welcome back, everybody. Welcome back. Welcome back. Welcome back.
I'm glad. I'm not glad to see you wiping your tears, because I think that's what we were doing in our breakout room too. And it's like, this is so deep. And it's Michelle, by the way.
Michelle, thank you. Yes. Michelle, I was hoping you're gonna tell me officially.
I was gonna unmute and let you know how much I'm loving this. I'm loving Teddy. I'm gonna cry. I'm gonna stop now.
your tears are welcome here. Yeah, take that breath. Take a breath. Everyone take a breath. I'm so glad that Beth and her team invested in giving this time, right? Because maybe what normally happens is somebody's going to give a bunch of facts and data and numbers. And I told her, that's not my work. You got to find somebody else for data and numbers and facts. And I'm about heart. And for some people, they're like, do we have resources to do heart work? I'm like, I think if you don't, you're going to be doing it somewhere else. You know what I'm saying? I think that. Let me hear from you. How was that experience for you? Without revealing anything confidential in your spaces, how was that experience for you? How was that for you? If anybody's willing to share out loud, Michelle, I would love to hear from you after you, if you're ready, or whenever you're ready.
I'm ready. You know, it was weird, because you said at the beginning, like, you don't have to share, as you know, you don't have to be too deep. We only talked for a few seconds the first time, but I don't know, there was something about the two women with me, and I just felt comfortable. And I went to, because I do feel, I mean, I think I put myself as a 10 this morning, and I'm the one who typed in the chat that I feel blessed, because no matter what, I do feel blessed, even if it's, I'm going through something hard. So, but it is that mask that, I think that's what got me, like, that, what we hide. Even for us, I think sometimes we don't even admit it to ourselves. You know, the mask is, it's meant to hide it from other people, but I think sometimes we hide our true feelings and stuff from ourselves too. So it really got me. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Ashanti, it's Brenda. I think what this exercise provided for, it was just me and Jean, for us was just a safe place to just, whereas maybe other places you're not able to be as safe and open, for us, this is what this provided. So it was really, really refreshing.
Thank you, Brenda. Just so you all know, Brenda and I know each other. We've done some work in Pleasanton, and we had a circle of boys. We call it the Head, Heart, Health Summit. And we took the boys, middle school and high school, through this activity. It was in person. It was before the pandemic, and it was beautiful. It was beautiful. And so good to see you here, Brenda. Thank you. Anyone else feeling called to say something? I know maybe some people are putting it in the chat. I see some more things coming in the chat. Does anyone feel open to share anything out loud?
Can I go?
Yeah, please, please.
No, thank you for the space. I wasn't expecting this from the training. I was going to be doing a lot of different notes for myself because I have PTSD, so I always have to write in order for me to understand. But thank you for the space. I think it's beautiful that whenever we have the time and the space and definite someone like you to bring us into ourselves, because I do a group every Thursday, and definite for that 2 hours, I have to be like very energized and very caring. And I'm always, it's not something that you try, it's that you have it within you. So I'm always telling everybody like the beauty that they have as humans and the resiliency and the strengths that they have. And I'm so capable of having 40 in the virtual group and tell everybody their unique way of how I see them. But when it comes to me, it's like you ask me the questions and it's like it takes me really a long time to really figure out what is it that I feel about myself. And it's part of being facilitators of the group is to be able to also see that as yourself with the beauty and also the things that you don't like about yourself. But you still are that human being that want to continue transforming and things like that. So thank you very much for this space that you have given me. You have a beautiful soul. And I wish this could be more time and more available for us in the community. One thing that I have experienced to being 27 years working in a domestic violence field is that before I used to be in those groups where I used to be the survival, and I'm a survival of so many different things. But then once you start working in the field is that you lose that support because there is no groups for you know, people that work in the community. So it was just wonderful the way that came out today. I wasn't expecting it, but it happened and I'm glad that it did. So thank you.
Thank you, Sonia. Thank you so much. Anyone else?
This is Beth. I just want to really appreciate you, Ashanti, for being here. This is, gosh, we just don't have enough opportunities for this. And it's really true. I feel grateful to be part of a number of 12-step communities where this kind of experience is common. So I just felt like I wanted to offer that up.
Thank you, Beth. Thanks for making this possible for all of you. Anyone else? Maybe somebody's feeling called to say one word, to say, what did you take away from that experience? Maybe you don't have you don't want to say a long sentence. Maybe you just got one word. Maybe it's one word you've taken away with you. While you're thinking about that one word, I'm going to show you, we created in our work, we created this game called The Adventure. It's called Ever Forward Club, The Adventure. And the way we designed the game we put some gamification in it. So the goal of the game is to save a character from this dangerous destination. And the way you get points in this game is by answering questions. And the questions can range from lots of different things. There's lots of different categories of the questions. So let me give you an example. Let me just show you a couple examples. So the questions are, some are easier and some are harder, right? So this is let me see if I can probably get these to focus. This is a challenge card. This is a challenge. So this says, what is your most vivid memory from your childhood, right? And this is a 1 or 3 point question, right? So you get 1 or 3 points with this one. And one is just saying, I'm going to answer lightweight, right? I'm going to just answer light. I don't want to tell a deep one. I'm going to just tell a light one. But you choose the points, right? And 3 says, I'm going to go a little deeper. And everyone self-selects how many points they get, because it's not us to judge how you answer. This is the big boss. This is one of the harder ones. This is a 5-point question, right? The big boss. You can see the big boss at the top of the steps up there. The exit to the cave is behind the big boss, ironically. But this is what this one says. What was the most extreme emotion? This is a hard one that you've experienced. Ooh, what is most? That's a 5-point question, right? So you can go light or go deep, right? Let me go. This is weathering the storm. This is, tell us, I'm sorry, I'm trying to get the lighting right. Sorry, I got this light right here. Tell us about a time when someone earned your trust. Weathering the storm, see the boat in the storm. 2 more categories. One is called sunrise, sunset. That's things that are starting and ending, sunrise, sunset. So it says, what is something that you need to start doing? Sunrise, sunset, right? Some things that need to start, some things need to stop. And the last one is leap of faith. That's a harder question. And this is one of the samples from that question, leap of faith. And it says, there we go. Where in your life do you feel the need for more effective boundaries? That's a 5-point question. 1 point or 5 points. So it's always everyone can get a point. And the way we created it was to help people build connection. I think you imagine those, I just gave you a couple of examples, but there's 80 questions. And it's really just about how do we come together and really make space to have these deeper conversations. And so I'll put a video, there is for educators, educators of all kinds, our community has sponsored educators to receive these decks. So if you would like to have a deck, if you consider yourself an educator, you can always buy one, but the community has sponsored educators to receive one. So I'm going to put the link so that you can do that. We're mailing them out. We put one shipping yesterday. Today is Wednesday. Hopefully by Monday, we'll have another shipment going out. There's a webinar next week to like use this in a kind of a classroom setting, but you can also, the instructions will come in the box itself. So let me, educator pack, here's where you sign up for that. Team the game. So I want to make sure leave time for questions. So let me, see if there's any questions right now. And then I'm going to show you, okay, sign up for your EFC adventure. I'm going to make sure I get that link in the chat so you have that. And someone asked for the song, the video. So I'm gonna put the video. Oops, sorry. Everyone, boom. Okay. And then I'll put the link for a video where you can see people playing the game. You'll see a sample of people playing the game. It's just a one-on-one game. And then after that, I'll take some questions. So here's a video of playing the game, boom. And you can grab that link also. And let me see. Okay, I wanted to show you something else. Okay, so I want to show you something else. So there we go. I'm taking a breath. There we go. All right. So what I have is I want to show you how we designed this site. So I want to show you how you can use it. So if somebody can just unmute themselves and just tell me, for example, the age and the maybe the gender of one of your people that you're thinking about the most, whether it's a friend, client, family member, somebody you're thinking about the most, somebody you've been thinking about, you've been wondering about. I'm going to share the screen with you. So just give me the age and gender of that person. And what I'm going to show you is what we've created in this tool. Let me go to the mask gallery, the full mask gallery. Is we created this tool so you can actually go in and create your own account. If you were doing this as a workshop with people, you could have them make their mask. The mask will show up online. But what you can do is you will be able to create an educator view. So my educator view is all the masks that have been made with codes that I created. So let's say, let me see, did anybody give me an age or a gender yet? Just so I can show you how it works. I can make it up too, but.
24.
Okay, so age, I'm gonna put age 24. And you wanna give it a gender?
Female.
Okay. So what will happen in this is these are all the ones that have been made under my code. So I've only have two people who've made masks under my codes. Nagatuk, a female there from Nagatuk, and 24, and a 24 female from Berkeley. So if, for example, I went to the full mask gallery, I'm gonna go to the, so these are just the ones that have made masks under my code. See, my name is in the corner here, Ashanti in the top right corner. I have codes that I've created. But if I go to the full mask gallery, I can just show anyone that same thing, 24, and I can put in female. And this will pull up all the masks that have been made all over from all over the world. So you see, this is Nagatuk, the one that was there in my code. And then Holt, San Francisco, graduate school. I'll click on this so you can see it bigger. And what it allows us to do, sometimes when we're talking to people, they may think that they're the only ones going through what they're going through, right? And sometimes it's hard to say, it sounds like a cliche that you're not alone, but it always sometimes feels like it. And what we get to do in this tool is if someone says they're going through fear, we can pull up other masks of other people, 24 female, who may be also going through fear. But with now, since it's just 24 female, they're from all over the world, Seaside, Tulare, Minneapolis, Portland, Fremont, California, Redwood City, Daly City, Berkeley, Fresno. It'll keep going. It's all Boston, Sacramento, Charlotte, Bowling Green, Ohio. You'll see masks from all over the world. Well, maybe not all over the world for every age and every gender, but there are masks from over 40 different countries. And what we get to see is that we're not alone. They get to see it. They get to see a person, anonymous, who have shared a little bit about their story. And it allows us to be able to build deeper connection with people we're working with who may have a hard time visualizing anybody could possibly be going through what they're going through. And what this tool allows us to do is it also allows us to type in a search word. So if there was a word that that person was dealing with that you wanted to show them, let me go from some young men. I'm gonna go to male. I'm gonna take off the age. I'll leave 24. Let's leave 24. And I'll, one of the young men I'm dealing with is dealing with a lot of sadness. And it's gonna pull up the ones that use the word sadness. Now, sadness is specific, right? There's two of them. But if I just put sad, because it does all different types of word, we don't filter the words. So you have those three are sad and the sadness. Now if I was gonna go fear, for that age doesn't show 24, doesn't show any. But what it allows me to do is to begin to like find those ways of connecting, because most times what we see for young men is if we know that on the outside they're showing they're happy, cool, right? Then we know that there's so much more happening that we can't see, right? Now, this is also 24. If I take off the age, then it opens up to all ages of men from all over, right? So that's so the more nuance you get, you may have less things to pull on. But this is how a tool we've created for you to use for free to be able to help build more connection, not only with the people you work with, but also just people in the world. And, you know, our only ask for you is that, you know, you just tell one person about it. We have a goal. Our goal, this is called the Million Mask Movement. Our goal is to collect 1 million masks from all over the world. It's not the number 1 million, but is what if more people around the world knew that they're not the only ones going through what they're going through? What if they knew that maybe the people that they hang around the most are also going through real stuff, but because they have not built a connection that is deeper than just the surface, then they will never know. And so that's part of the work. And so that's all I wanted to show you. I wanted to just let you see the tool. So I'll give the link so that you can, you'll be able to sign up there for yourself. If you wanted to create an account, I'm gonna put that link in the chat for you. And then, are there any questions before I move to the next part? Because I'm going to close out, and I just want to make sure that I leave room for questions if there are any.
Feel free to unmute yourself if you want to ask a question.
So I'm not sure if any of you have seen the documentary, The Mask You Live In. The Mask You Live In documentary features our work. That's when we first did the activity with the masks. That was back at Fremont High School in Oakland. I was a dean in 2012 and 13. And this is the work that's taken us around the world. And so I will show you this last thing as I get ready to close out. Let me show you this. Okay.
Are you still doing work in Oakland Unified?
We're trying, you know, it's been a, you know, wild year and a half. So we're working right now with one young man who's at Fremont High School, who's going to be starting a club there. We're doing work in Alameda, in Hayward, in Castro Valley. So a lot, you know, we're
in tech.
Every year we would love to be back at tech. I think Ms. Morrison was our last contact there. So I don't know the new principal there. But if you have a contact, we would love, we have the 24-hour relay every year at Tech, well, after 2019, but we would love to do the work there. I know there's a lot of needs. There's a lot of needs in a lot of our schools, right? So if you have a contact and you reach out, we created a tool, not only the game, we created a box that allows, trains educators to be able to do this work in their classes. And we can always go in and do it. You know, that requires us to, you know, the school to have the resources for that, but we also have ways of us being able to provide that support at a lower cost if they want to do the box and the tool. So, yeah.
There's an interesting question about working on your own individual turmoil and any thoughts you had about, you know, that other side of the mask and suggestions you have, Ashanti, for people that want to do work on that or?
Yeah.
You therapy, know, I mentioned 12.
So. Yeah, you know, thank you for that. And I don't have any of the apps that I recommend right now but I do know there's a lot of resources out there. I'm on a men's team. So I've been on a men's team for the last 10 years. So every Tuesday night from 7 to 10 p.m., I meet with that group of men. And some weeks I'm there to support other men and some weeks they're there to support me. And it's a way for finding those spaces. So I've worked on a lot of it through those spaces. I've also done a lot of men's retreats of healing men through the Mankind Project, so there's lots of organizations that are out there that are building awareness. I know there's an event coming up for Sacred Sons. And I just learned of one that they created for women identifying folks. I think it's called Sacred Sisters, I think it's called. If you email me, I'll put my email in the chat.
Great.
I can share those resources. I don't have it memorized and on easily accessible, but I mean, it's easily accessible. Just, you know, I got to find it.
There's also some programs that we're doing here at First Five through one is called Ubuntu Groups for African-American people of African descent and also emotional emancipation circles that I think have been quite and engaging for people. So that's going to be coming up. And anyone who's interested, I'll put my email in the chat and people can reach out to me as well about those upcoming things.
Ashanti, what are those t-shirts behind you?
So this is our, if you go to our website, our team has been working on trying to build those out, everforwardclub.org. So these are from the campaign. When the mask first started in 2016, that was our first shirt. This one here is called, remember that artist I was telling you about, the artist who was one of our students? Maybe this would be the last thing I'll share with you. This is his art. So if you look on the outside of that face, it says, I'm okay on the outside. Mm-hmm. I'm okay. But if you look a little closer in between, I'm okay, can you see a word written there? It's kind of hard to see. It says not. It's hard. It's kind of hard to see. It's actually hard to see on purpose. He wrote not over there, over the mouth, because he said, you know, if you're okay, it's actually easy to talk about. But it's harder to talk about. And so he put it over the mouth, and it's already hard to see if somebody's not doing okay.
So we can get them from your website.
You can. Okay. Everyforclub.org. Thank you for asking. Everyforclub.org. And our team will be happy to hear that. They've just rebuilt the store, online store. So thank you for asking. Thank you all so much for being here today. I appreciate you all. And please stay in touch. You know, you can find us anywhere at Everforclub. And hopefully our work will serve the work you're doing. And thank you. I saw some of the thank yous in the chat. I really appreciate all of you for being here today. And again, thank you, Beth. And thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much. And thank you, Ashanti. Thank you, everyone, for being here. Please fill out your evaluation. If you want more trainings like this from the heart that impact, please let us know. This is what we want to reach out and have programs and opportunities that are helpful to you.
Everybody.
Bye, everyone. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you all. Stay in touch.